Thank you, choir. The blood of Jesus speaks for me. How many of you are glad for that tonight? And I'll tell you what it says. The blood of Jesus says, forgiven. Let's stand together as we sing tonight. Send the light. That's what this missions conference is all about. Sending the light all around the world. Sing it out together.
There's a call comes ringing o'er the restless way. Send the light. Send the light. There are souls to rescue. There are souls to save. Send the light. Send the light. Send the light. The blessed gospel light. Let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light. The blessed gospel light. Let it shine forevermore. Let us not grow weary in the work of love. Send the light. Send the light. Let us gather jewels for a crown above. Send the light. Send the light. Send the light. The blessed gospel light. Let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light. The blessed gospel light. Let it shine forevermore.
To know the light is still shining in Egypt tonight, still shining in the Philippines, still shining in Nigeria, still shining in Lancaster, California, and we want to keep that light shining. Take a few minutes right now and shake hands with those around you. Maybe find a missionary nearby you and welcome them tonight. You to look at the screen up here. It says, let us not grow weary in the work of love. Let's say that together. Let us not grow weary in the work of love. One more time. Let us not. And sometimes you have busy days, and there's all kinds of stuff going on today. There's a little election going on today, and had a little rain today, and some of us put in a few hours, and yet the Bible says in Galatians 6:9, that we're not to grow weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall what? Reap, if we faint not. So I want you to sing this song tonight and lift up your voice on this. Let us not grow weary in the work of love. I want the piano to play. I like it when the men play. I want you to pound those keys over there. I want you to lift your voice up and let's encourage each other in the Lord. Let's not grow weary. And by the way, it's a work of love. These missionaries, you know why they're going overseas? Because they love the Lord Jesus Christ. And so let's be missionaries here at home. Sing it out now. Brother Williams, help us out.
Ready? Let's sing it. Let us not grow weary in the work of love. Send the light. Send the light. Let us gather jewels for a crown of song this evening. You know, Old Testament and New Testament say that the just shall live by faith. As we live by faith, we'll advance the gospel. Let's sing this together. By faith we see the hand of God in the light of creation's grand design, in the lives of those who prove his faithfulness, who walk by faith. was called to hold in the power of the Spirit to the lost, to deliver captives and to preach good news in every corner of the earth. We will stand as children of the promise. We will fix our on him, our soul's reward, till the race is finished and the work is done. We'll walk by faith and not by sight. Now this next is right from the scripture. By faith, mountains shall be moved. Another great verse. Let's sing together. By faith, the mountain shall be moved. Shall prevail, for we know in Christ all things are possible. For all who call upon his name, we will stand as children of the promise. We will fix our eyes on him, our soul's reward, till the race is finished and the work is done. We'll walk by faith and not by sight. We will stand as children of the promise. We will fix our eyes on him, our soul's reward, till the race is finished and the work is done. We'll walk by faith and not by sight.
By faith and not by sight. Some churches call this card that I have in my hand tonight the faith promise card, because when you fill out the card, you really don't know what a year will bring. You don't know if the economy will be up or down, or if there'll be inflation, or really what's going to happen. You're just saying, Lord, I'm going to honor you with the tithe. I'm going to support the missionaries. I'm going to be a part of the work. And by faith, we follow God. And if you have to figure it all out, you'll never live by faith. There's just this matter of saying, Lord, I'm going to trust you. And I know that tonight and even on Sunday, there'll be some in our church for the very first time decide to begin tithing. And it's going to be faith. I remember when Terry and I, before we were even married, we were doing a little workbook for engaged couples. And there was a chapter on tithing. And Terry was a little more mature than I was at that time. Of course, I'm much more mature now, of course, but I don't know about that even now sometimes. But she had a very established giving pattern as a young single woman. And sad to say, mine was a little bit too sporadic, and she'd already been giving tithes and missions offerings every week. And when we started talking about giving, it convicted me. And I realized if I was going to be the leader of the home, I better get with the program. And but to do that, it took faith. And I was making about $220 a week back then. And I thought, man, $22 a week for the tithe. And on top of that, for missions. But we went ahead and filled out our first card, I'll never forget that, up in Northern California. We were required to go to a missions conference at a church somewhere by our college. And aren't you all glad, all the students, you're already in a church. You don't have to go find a missions conference. We done found one for you. And here we all are learning about how to keep the work of God going forward. But it will take faith tonight, and I hope you're ready for that. And let's pray as the choir gets ready to sing. Let's pray and ask God to bless, shall we? Father, give us the faith that we need tonight to send the light all around the world, Lord, through the missionary program. Father, we just thank you for the beautiful song the choir has given us tonight about the blood. And now we have some teenagers that are going to sing, Lord. And I pray that some of these teenagers would surrender their lives to be missionaries and that they would begin to think now about others. Thank you for them. Bless this service tonight, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
But we know the name of the light. In a day so divided, we have the love that unites. Jesus, Jesus, He is hope, hope, hope for all nations, hope. The prodigal hearts back home. The truth for the lonely that you are never alone. Jesus, Jesus, He is hope, hope, hope for all nations, hope. Hope, hope for all nations, hope, hope forever.
Thank you, young people. Wasn't that a blessing? Let's thank the teenagers once again for such a beautiful song. I saw the Ukrainian flag a moment ago, and I felt that we should pray for Ukraine tonight. And there's so much suffering there, and there are many Christians there. And there are different political views about how much money to send and military support. But I will tell you that 2 years ago, the government of Ukraine allowed Christian organizations to give a Bible to every student in every school in that country. And some have said, well, they're a corrupt government. I think every government's probably corrupt. But I'm always glad when even corrupt governments let Bibles get passed out somewhere. And Brother Williams, why don't you come and pray for Ukraine and for those that are suffering there, and just ask the Lord to help. We have a missionary right now in Odessa, and he emails me about once a week. And he says, my son and I, we're going to bed tonight with our gun loaded. And he says, we hear the bombs in the distance dropping. He sent his wife and daughter to the States. His daughter will be a freshman in a few weeks here in our college. And he's just being faithful, Brother Kochachenko. And I want you to pray for him, Brother Kochachenko, and pray for the churches that are there in Ukraine before we move along tonight.
Lord Jesus, we thank you for how you've met with us in our World Impact Missions Conference. Lord, we think of Ukraine. We think that, Lord, we know that you're the sovereign God of the entire world, and Lord of every nation, and Lord, every knee will bow before you one day. Lord, in a time right now, this country especially, Lord, where there's upheaval and chaos, God, I pray that you'll bless those believers there who are still trying to point others to you, and Lord, many missionaries in the other countries where the Ukrainians are fleeing to, I pray, God, that you will bless them. Lord, the Kochachenko family, God, I pray that you'll bless them, have your hand upon their lives. And God, we even think of our nation and the votes today and all things going on here. But Lord, again, we thank you that you're in control. I pray, Lord, tonight that we, as a local church and leadership of our pastor, that we'll vote for the gospel to go forward here in the valley and around the world to the uttermost parts of the earth. And Lord, you'll be pleased with all of these things. We pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. It has been said that a church's blessings and success is not only measured by its seating capacity, but also by its sending capacity. And we want to be a sending church. And I'm so thankful that some of our own missionaries are here with us this week, members of Lancaster Baptist Church, like the Youngs and the Hutchins and others that are with us. And I want Brother Sam Hutchins to come tonight and give us an update on what God is doing in New Zealand. Brother Hutchins was a member of our church, member of our staff here in this ministry, and God called him to go overseas with the gospel. And he's going to share a report with us and give us a challenge tonight briefly about New Zealand. Let's welcome Brother Hutchins tonight.
Well, it's been about 5 years since our family moved from Southern California to the South Island of New Zealand and began working in the city of Christchurch, New Zealand. And we're thankful for all that God has done over those 5 years. Primarily, he's allowed us to help see established the Lighthouse Baptist Church of Christchurch. Pastor Chapel came down in 2019 to oversee that chartering service. We had a wonderful week with him down there and a wonderful Sunday when he was there. And over these last few years since then, we've been trying to do what New Testament churches do, and that is win people to Christ and baptize them and disciple them and see them grow in the Lord. And we're thankful for all that God has done in that regard. Our Chinese ministry, I mentioned it on Sunday in the video, has been one of the really bright spots of what God has allowed to happen down there. Brother Warren Bale, many of you know Brother Bale. He's been here a few times. He's on the advisory board for the college, has been absolutely instrumental in that and has helped lead that in our church and seen many Chinese come to Christ. And there's just been a lot of things. I could tell you lots and lots of stories of all that God has done over these last few years. But needless to say, even in a tough country like New Zealand, where folks are very much hard to the gospel, people are still getting saved, and they're still getting baptized, and they're still growing in the Lord. And that's what we're thankful to be a part of. And I have to say this, coming back 5 years later, considering all that has happened over the last 5 years, especially over the last two or three, it's a blessing to my heart to see so many of you still faithful and in your place after everything that has gone on. And I see a lot of new faces, and it's wonderful to see new faces, but it's a real blessing to me to see some of you that we knew when we were in Bible college and when we were here as members of Lancaster Baptist Church and part of the staff here. And I just want to say thank you for just staying faithful. Amen. To be here and supporting missionaries like us. And we're going back to New Zealand on Thursday, and we are going back refreshed and renewed and excited to continue in the work there. And part of the reason for that is because we've come back and we've seen and been reminded again of just how wonderful ascending church we have that is standing behind us. And so thank you for your faithfulness to us. Tonight, as we think about our giving commitments, and we think about the election that we're having in this room, not the one that's outside of these walls, but the one that's going on in this room, the verse that comes to my mind is Romans chapter 12 and verse number 1. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. The word therefore is incredibly important to understanding that verse. The word therefore references something that has already been said in previous passages of Scripture. And I believe, we don't have time to build this thought out, but I believe that if you were to look at what therefore is referring to, it's really referring to everything that has been written in Romans prior to that point. And Romans is all about our salvation, how we were guilty, but through faith we're justified. And that being justified, we now have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And that nothing can separate us from the love of Christ. And Paul says, on that basis, I beseech you, therefore, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice. Crazy thing is, we can't present our bodies as a living sacrifice and hold anything back. It's kind of total. We have to present everything if we're going to present our bodies to God, our entire person. Everything about us, including our wallets, but also our families and our careers and everything that pertains to us needs to go on the altar for God to use how he sees fit. And I love what Paul says at the end of that verse. The reason why is because it is your reasonable service. The Greek word behind that is logikos. We get it, logic, from that word. It's just logical. If he gave himself for us, why would we not give ourselves back to him? And as you fill out your card tonight, I hope that you think about that a little bit. We think about the Apostle Paul teaching on giving in 2 Corinthians 8. And what does he say? In light of the gift that the Macedonians gave at the end of that, he says, thanks be to God for his unspeakable gift. The greatest gift to missions was God's gift of his son, Jesus Christ. A couple of years ago, I got a phone call from Pastor Paul Brinkman. Many of you know who Pastor Brinkman is. He often comes for leadership conferences. He's a native New Zealander. He lives in Auckland, about an hour's flight from our family. He called me up and he said, Brother Sam, I've got a request for you. I'd like you to go and visit a lady who is in Christchurch right now. He said she doesn't live in Christchurch. She lives in Nelson. Nelson's about 5 hours north of us. He said, but we've known her for a long time. We knew her when she used to live in Auckland. We've witnessed to her several times. She's never been saved. He said, but she just found out that she has been diagnosed with terminal cancer. And he said, I think she might be willing to listen if you'd be willing to go talk to her. He said, she's in the Daffodil House, which is a cancer lodging house there in our city. He said, do you think you can go see her? I said, I can go see her right now if she's available. And I packed up my things and I drove over to where she was with her cancer treatments. And her name was Jane. I sat across from her and I began to talk to her, and I talked to her about her diagnosis and the things that she was facing, and she began to weep. You could tell she was very clearly scared of having received this diagnosis. And I said, Jane, if you died today, and I said, I know you're facing death now because of your diagnosis, but are you sure that you'd go to heaven? And she said, no, that's the thing. I don't know what happens after I die. She says, I'm terrified. And I said, well, can I show you from the Bible what it says about after what happens after we die? And she said, I'd love to know that. And I spent about 30, 45 minutes with her. And at the end of that time, she bowed her head. She trusted Christ in that room. I called Pastor Brinkman as soon as I got back in the car. I was so excited to tell him, but he didn't answer his phone. So I drove for a few minutes and he called me back and he said, hey, have you seen Jane? And I said, yeah, I just got done talking to her. And he said, what happened? And I said, well, let me play it for you, because I had kind of secretly snuck my phone into my pocket because I knew he'd want to hear. And I played the recording of her talking to me a little bit and of her praying to trust Christ as her Savior. And I could hear Pastor Paul and Miss Hannah, his wife, in the background just weeping over the fact that this woman had trusted Christ. She went back to Nelson a couple days later. She never once attended our church. She didn't live in Christchurch. About 6 months later, she died. Before she died, she asked Pastor Brinkman, she said, you got to come to my funeral. You got to preach the gospel. She said, my relatives, my friends, my neighbors, they need what I have found. Her exact words were, that motley lot needs to hear this. Pastor Paul went down there, and to a group of people who probably never heard the gospel before, he preached the gospel at her funeral. A bunch of people came up to him afterwards, shook his hand, and said, thank you, Pastor Paul, for preaching that and telling us about the gospel. They said, we knew something had happened to Jane. She was just different. We didn't know exactly what had gone on, but we knew that something had changed in her life. Here's the thing. Pastor Brinkman, once early in his life, decided that he was going to present his body as a living sacrifice, and he invested in Jane. When I was a teenager, I decided I was going to present my body as a living sacrifice, and that put me in Christ Church, ready to be there and to get to experience the harvest there, the increase. But I was there because Lancaster Baptist Church had a bunch of members that decided to present their bodies as a living sacrifice. And together, because of your sacrifice, because of my sacrifice, because of Pastor Brinkman's sacrifice, Jane is in heaven tonight. And when you think about all that put together, it just doesn't feel much like a sacrifice. It just feels reasonable. Think about that while you fill your cards out tonight. We love you guys. Thank you.
Thank you so much. That's what we get to be a part of as we participate tonight. It's our privilege. And for all of us in this room, for those of you online, we want to be a part of this worldwide evangelization. I want you to hold your seats there and be seated, but we're going to sing another song. And I want you to think about the words to this song written by Dr. John R. Rice. It speaks about the fact that there's so little time to reach this world. And let's sing this song together with Brother Williams.
So little time, the harvest will be over, our reaping done, we reapers taken home. Report our work to Jesus, Lord of harvest, and hope he'll smile and that he'll say, well done. Today we reap or miss our golden harvest. Today is given us lost souls to win. Oh, then to save some dear ones from the burning, today we'll go to bring some sinner in. The harvest wide with reapers few is wasting, and many souls will die and never know the love of Christ, the joy of sins forgiven. Oh, let us weep and love and pray and go. Today we reap or miss our golden harvest. Today is given us lost souls to save some dear ones from the burning. Today we'll go to bring some sinner in.
We really have a wonderful group of missionaries this year, and I've enjoyed getting to know them. Several are new, young, and tender-hearted and ready to go to the field. And I want you to meet one of those that is new tonight, and that is Brother Colin Hendricks. Brother Hendricks, if you'll come and just give a greeting to our church, and I believe you have a video for us to see. And here's a man that's going to a very large and needy city that has a history with the gospel but needs a revival, and going over to London, England. And we're glad you're in our conference, and let's welcome Brother Hendricks tonight.
Well, I just want to say thank you, Pastor Chapel, for having us, and thank you, Lancaster Baptist Church, for your hospitality and greeting us. This is our first time here, and we're very, very thankful for the opportunity. England is a very small country with a gigantic need, if I can say it that way. And London is a huge city with a big need as well. 9.5 million people live in London, and they're from every corner of the globe. And once again, we're thankful to be here, thankful for the opportunity, excited to hear stories like Brother Sam just shared, and we want to be a part of that. And we're thankful for the opportunity to share our burden, and I pray that the video helps you feel like you've been there, but also helps you see the need. Thank you.
England, a country rich in world and religious history, known for the royal family, renowned authors such as Charles Dickens and William Shakespeare, red buses, black cabs, tea, and a variety of unique accents. This small island country is only 300 miles across at its largest point, and yet the impact that it has had upon the modern world is remarkable. During the 18th century, a spark of the gospel ignited, resulting in revivals that cut across denominational lines and straight to the souls of men, touching every class of society and producing many great preachers and missionaries. For years, God used England as the epicenter of the gospel to be spread across the globe. However, England has since fallen from its pinnacle of gospel influence. The English people have grown cold to the gospel and their need for the Savior. With modern conveniences and technology, God and His Word have become a relic of the past and the lies of the English. This mindset is especially felt in the capital city, London. London is home to nearly 9.5 million people and is bustling with life, creativity, and energy. It is a place that takes enormous pride in its diverse and cosmopolitan culture. In an address to the city, Mayor Sadiq Khan said, "London is the world in one city, with more than 300 languages spoken on our streets. The fact that we are home to people of every color, class, culture, and creed is precisely what makes London so special. Considering the vast number of immigrants from all around the world who have made the Big Smoke their home, the religious demographic of London is extremely vast. Almost half of the city claim Christianity as their religion, but merely in word and not in practice. The majority of those who do attend Christian churches believe in a works-based salvation and not a personal relationship with God. Many also claim to be agnostic or atheist, while Muslim and Hindu influences are making headway throughout the city. Although many Londoners claim some form of religion, the city is predominantly in a post-church era in practice. We are the Hendricks family, and God has called us to plant churches in this spiritually desolate city. Will you prayerfully consider partnering with us as we endeavor to take the gospel back to England?"
Kule. My name is Ben Fassenro, and my family are missionaries to Nigeria, West Africa, and I am a senior.
Hola, my name is Joseph Tate, and my family are missionaries to the country of Honduras, and I'm a freshman.
Sawadika, I'm Faith Cohn. My family are missionaries to Thailand, and I'm a sophomore.
Oliotia, my name is Michelle Virgin, and my family are missionaries to Uganda, East Africa, and I'm a junior.
Inriano Michelmunina, my name is Mary Elizabeth Kearney, and my family are missionaries in Ghana, West Africa, and I'm a freshman.
Buenas noches, my name is Rebecca Case, my family are missionaries to Mexico City, and I'm a sophomore.
Venter, and I am from the country of Laos. My family are missionaries over there, and I'm a senior.
Hola, my name is Ruth Case. My family are missionaries to Mexico City, and I am a sophomore.
At Casson, my name is Alexa Vicinero. My family are missionaries to Nigeria, West Africa, and I'm a junior. And at the piano is Emma Benefield. Her family are missionaries to Cambodia, and she is a sophomore.
Young people, just stay here 1 second before you run off the platform. You've heard of PKs, pastor's kids. These are MKs, missionaries' kids, and we love them, and we're so glad they chose West Coast Baptist College. And when they talk about in Christ alone, they're here by faith. When Thanksgiving comes in a few days, many of these students will be 10,000 miles away from their parents. That's the faith they express to come here. And you'll probably hear an announcement or two about having some kids to your home for Thanksgiving. And I hope you'll look at this platform and you'll love them and you'll encourage them. I remember when I was a freshman in Bible college, my parents lived in Seoul, South Korea, and Thanksgiving came, and it was a lonely time. That's when I fell in love with Terry, and the rest is history. And I'll tell you, it can feel awkward when you're a long way from home. Imagine having your parents in Laos or in Africa. And I just wanted to say that so that you'll look at their faces and remember them and love them through Bible college, because they're going to do a great work for God on the mission field themselves. So would you thank them again for that beautiful song? Thank you so much. That was beautiful. Well, tonight, as we come to the closing moments of our conference, we'll have an opportunity in just a moment to meet all of our missionaries one more time as we make our pledges tonight. But we want to hear from one of the greatest missionaries of all time, a true missiologist, a man who understands missions, a man who loves missionaries. And Brother Sisk has been my mentor, not only in missions, but in so many ways for my life in ministry philosophy. And he's been a blessing to this church. We supported two missionaries the first time he preached for us. And now tonight, he's here helping us support some more missionaries. And Brother Sis, we love you. And we're excited about your message tonight. And I want you to join me in welcoming Dr. Don Sisk to Lancaster Baptist Church tonight.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Please be seated. For many, many years, I was a member of the Highland Park Baptist Church in Chattanooga, Tennessee. And time after time, I heard Dr. Lee Robertson make the statement, everything rises and falls on leadership. And I am so proud to be a member of Lancaster Baptist Church. I'm so glad that when I came out to preach in a leadership conference in 2002, right after I had resigned as president and general director of BIMI, that Dr. Mark Rasmussen and Dr. Paul Chappell had my future planned out for me. They hadn't said anything to me about it, but they and so they persuaded me that I should come out here and teach missions one semester. And I did. For 14 years in a row, I taught missions one semester. And when we got out here, and you know, we were members of Highland Park Baptist Church, I thought, okay, we're going to be here several months, so we're going to join the church. We go back to Chattanooga, we'll join Highland Park again. And we joined the church here, and it's a wonderful time. We went back to Chattanooga, and Highland Park Baptist Church had changed radically. And I said, we're not joining this church. We're still going to be going to Lancaster more than any other church, so I'm still a member, and I'm going to be a member till I die, whether you like it or not, okay? But so tonight, of all the people, and we've had a wonderful conference this year. I mean, preachers, every time I hear Sam Hutchins, I get real jealous. Nobody should have a voice that good. And some of these other preachers, man, we've had a wonderful, wonderful time of preachers and so forth, and it's been great. But my pastor and his dear wife, Terry, are some of the greatest people I've ever met in my life. So I want us to thank him tonight, okay? And help me do that, okay? So go ahead and stand. Thank you, Pastor. And we met one time when both of us wondered why we were there. And the only reason we was there is so we could meet each other, okay? And I love Lancaster Baptist Church. After I resigned as president from BIMI, I had several opportunities. But I believed after hearing the messages that Dr. Chappell and just spending hours and hours with him in different kinds of situations and so forth, that I knew he had a heart for the world. And I think it was 1991, the first time I preached down at the church down on the boulevard. And we had a wonderful time then. And I really felt that one day, Lancaster could be the center of world evangelization. By the way, it has become that. I mean, we have more open doors today than we've ever had. And by the way, Pastor and the leadership of Lancaster Baptist Church, the deacons and so forth, are going through those open doors. And I believe from the depth of my heart at that time, when I first preached to the student body in one of the modular buildings, and I forget how many was there, but it didn't make any difference. You could just sense that something big was about to happen. And by the way, the past is prologue. You say, well, what does that mean? It means you ain't seen nothing yet, amen. And I believe the future is much greater. Open your Bibles to Luke chapter 16. Luke chapter 16. And I'm going to begin reading with verse 10. You follow me in your Bible, okay? You've stood several times, but let's go ahead and stand to honor God's word tonight, okay? Luke chapter 16, beginning with verse 10. He that is faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much. And he that is unjust in the least is unjust also in much. If therefore you have not been faithful with the unrighteous mammon, by the way, that's money, who will commit to you trust? Let me read that again. Who will commit to your trust the true riches? That's eternal riches. And if you've not been faithful in that which is another man's, who will give you that which is your own? No servant can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. Let's pray. Dear Lord, I thank you for the Bible, the infallible and inerrant word of God. And dear Lord, I pray that through this and the many other scriptures we'll use tonight, that you'll speak to our hearts. Lord, I thank you for what our eyes have seen, our ears have heard, and our hearts have felt in the last few days. Thank you, dear Lord, for the opportunity to be in this great mission conference with so many wonderful men and women have given their lives to go around the world to preach the gospel. They're starting churches here in America and all around the world. Thank you, dear Lord, for letting us be a little part of that. Now bless the message tonight. Lord, not because of the messenger, but because of what's preached. Preaching is important. So, Lord, I pray you would anoint my mind that I could think right. I need that. Anoint my lips that I could speak right. But most of all, dear Lord, I pray you anoint my heart that I could be right. And, Lord, we'll promise you again tonight that whatever you do tonight or any time in our lives, we'll give you all the honor and all the glory. We do not desire it. We do not deserve it. You do. And we'll praise you for all you do in Jesus' name. Amen. Notice the simple statement, and this is a very interesting passage, and we're not going into all of it. But in verse 10, it just simply says, if you'll be faithful in little things, you would be faithful if you had much. If you're unfaithful in the little things that God puts in your hand, then you would be unfaithful if God put big things in your hand. By the way, he's not going to do that, okay? And then I like the statement in verse 13. No servant can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. Now, by the way, money is not a bad thing. People that don't have any might say it's bad because they don't have any, amen. Money is a very good servant, but it is a very poor master. You cannot serve God and mammon. Let me give you two or three simple principles about ownership. Number one, think about this. Everything in the world belongs to God. Everything. Four times in the scripture, we find these very words. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. In other words, he owns everything. Hebrews 11:6 says, through faith we understand that the worlds, and that doesn't just mean planet earth, but the entire universe were formed by the word of God. God formed the entire universe with a word. Say, well, okay, you're from Kentucky, you're old, you've never heard about the Big Bang Theory. And I have. And I thoroughly adhere to it. God spoke and bang, there it was, amen. Genesis 1, God said and it was, God said and it was, God said and it was. So God owns the entire universe. Colossians tells us that it was created by him and for him. Everything in the universe belongs to God. Everything we have is a gift from God. Amen. Or you say, Brother Don, you're a preacher. Everything you have may be a gift from God. But I work hard for what I've got. Thank you. And who gives you the power to work? In him we live and move and have our being. We could do absolutely nothing without him. So everything that I have and everything you have came from God. All good and perfect gifts come from above. In whom there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Everything I have belongs to God. Huh? By the way, it's not mine. It's not mine. God's put it in my hand. I'm a steward, but I don't own it. It belongs to God. Everything. And that's the reason Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6, verses 19-20, lay not up for yourself treasures on earth where moth and rust corrupt, where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourself treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust corrupt, where thieves do not break through nor steal. And Jesus is simply saying to his disciples, don't get too heavily involved in earthly, temporal things. Why? Number one, they are temporal. And anything bad can happen to them. Anything you call your own, anything I call my own, anything bad can happen to it. You buy a new automobile, it begins to depreciate. If you're in places where they have a lot of snow and so forth, it begins to rust. You buy a new suit or a new dress, first thing you know, it begins to shrink. Or you begin to expand, amen? And, you know, it doesn't matter what we have. Anything that I have, anything bad, anything materialistically that I have, anything bad can happen to it. Anything. And then one day, and by the way, we're not going to live very long on this earth. You say, well, brother, sis, you've lived a long time. But in comparison to eternity, that is nothing. And when we die or when Jesus comes, we will not take anything with us. Anytime somebody of any wealth at all dies, someone invariably asks, I wonder how much he left. And it's always the same. He left it all. Somebody as well said, where there's a will, there's a lot of relatives. Amen. I mean, you're going to leave everything you have one day. We're not going to take one earthly thing to heaven with us, except that which we send ahead. So he said, don't get too heavily involved in earthly, temporal things. But get heavily involved in spirit. But lay up for yourself treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust do corrupt, and where thieves do not break through and steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Show me your checkbook, show me your budget, and I'll tell you exactly where your heart is. So nothing I have belongs to me. I am a steward. And since I am a steward, then one day I will give an account for everything God has given me. Now, for a long time, I heard people preaching about tithing, and we'll mention that in a minute. And they thought, okay, if you give 10% of what God gives you, then that's stewardship. No. We're not accountable to God for 10% for what he gives us. We are accountable to God for everything he gives us. So God owns everything in the universe. We don't own anything. We are stewards. And one day, we will stand before God and give an account for everything that he has put in our hand. The earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. Now, most of you people have heard this, okay? You say, well, Don, here he goes again, okay? Now, you've heard the story about the little girl that had never been on a farm, lived in the city all of her life. She went to visit her granddad and grandmother one time. And she had such a good time. She'd throw the corn over to the chickens and the pigs and so forth and gather eggs. And I mean, she woke up one morning and she said, Grandpa, today I'd like to milk a cow. And he said, now, honey, it's one thing to feed the pigs and you know, gather the eggs and so forth, but I don't think you can milk a cow. And she just kept crying. And by the way, when women and children can't get anything any other way, they can always cry, amen? And there's no defense on about a crying kid or a crying woman, okay? So the grandmother said, oh, the cow's gentle, let her go down and try it. And she went down there with the pail, and after a while, the grandpa went down there and see how she was doing. And lo and behold, she had the bucket sitting in front of the cow, and the cow was drinking the milk. And he said, hon, what were you doing? And she said, Grandpa, I got some out. But the old cow stepped her foot back in the pail and got it dirty, and I'm having to run it through again, okay? Okay. Let's run it through again, okay? This is the night when we get to make our commitments for a new year. By the way, I knew I was going to preach, so I've already filled mine out, amen? And I hope before the night's over that every person in this building would fill out that commitment card. Now, I'm going to give you a simple testimony of how God taught me to give. And by the way, I have absolutely nothing to boast about. If you knew where I came from, okay, you could appreciate it. I was born in 1933, and most of you know I'm 89 years old, and I know that surprises you. You thought I was 109, amen. And when I was born in Kentucky, my dad, a coal miner, worked very hard but made practically no money at all. And we did not have anything that we count as absolute necessities today. We had no radio. We had no telephone. We had no automobile. We had no wall-to-wall carpet. We didn't even have wall-to-wall flooring. There were cracks in some floor that you could see the ground. I mean, we did not have any electricity until I was a senior in high school. We had to watch television in the dark back in those days, amen? Now, you ought to laugh at that, okay? We had nothing. So, whatever I say tonight, no credit to Don Sisk, okay? But a credit to God. So let me tell you how God taught me to give. I trust you think about that card tonight and the things that are on the card. And just bear with me. Virginia and I got married and moved to Gary, Indiana. Joined a good old-fashioned Baptist church. We were both saved, but we knew nothing about personal separation or ecclesiastical separation or anything. But man, this old Baptist preacher up in Gary, Indiana, I mean, he preached against something we were doing every week. In fact, just about every week, we were going forward saying, we'll not do that anymore. I never will forget going to a drive-in theater and seeing Gary Cooper in High Noon. Man, that's a great movie. Guess what Brother Jones preached against the next day? Man, he hammered the Hollywood, and if you go to movies and pay your money, you know. And so just about every week, we were going forward and saying something. But, we'd been there about maybe 2 months, and one day, Brother Jones opened his Bible to Malachi chapter 3. And he taught us about tithing. And it's a very simple message. Malachi 3, will a man rob God, yet you've robbed me? But you say, wherein have we robbed thee? In tithes and offerings. Bring you all the tithes and offerings in the storehouse. See if I'll not open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing. Try me herewith, saith the Lord. See if I'll not open them. And he preached a real simple message about tithing. And I'm sure I had heard about tithing before, but, if I did, it just went in one ear and out the other, okay? But that day I listened. When he finished preaching, I went forward. Now, I want you to think about something. Everything God has taught me, I went to church. The man of God opened the Bible, Word of God, and taught and I listened and obeyed. It's that simple, okay? So he talked about the tithe is 10% of everything God gives you. By the way, Brother Sam preached about reasonable. If God gives us everything that we have, isn't it just reasonable that we give 10% of that back to his church? Isn't that the most reasonable thing you could think about? And so I went forward and I said, Brother Jones, I believe what you preached today, and from this moment on, I will give 10%, at least 10%, of everything God gives me to world, to the church. In other words, my gift to the church, the tithe. By the way, everybody ought to tithe. You say, well, I'm a college student. You ought to tithe. You say, I'm on welfare. You ought to tithe. You say, well, I make too much money to tithe. All right, pray that God will cut your salary. Amen? No. Everybody, there is absolutely no reason for anybody not to tithe. Brother Jones told our church about it. And he said, Don's come forward today, made a commitment to tithe. He prayed with me about it. And, hey, by the way, my tithe did not make an impact on Black Oak Baptist Church treasure. I was making $40 a week. My tithe was $4 a week. I didn't hear somebody say, good night, my tithe was just $4 a week. Oh, isn't my tithing? Oh, you only have $36 left. That's not much, amen? That didn't make an impact on the church, but it made an impact on me. Amen. You know what it proved? It proved me, and it's proved me over all of these years, that if I do what God told me to do, that God would do what he told me he would do. See, if I will not open the windows of heaven, and thank God he has. Amen. You could not pay me enough money to get me to quit tithing. Now, when I first started tithing, it was very legalistic. If I worked overtime, made $45, I'd give $4.50. I didn't want to overdo it. And I still get questions about tithing. Brother Sisk, you believe we ought to tithe off the gross income or the net income? That's a good question, isn't it? You've probably thought about that. Here's a simple answer. God has promised to bless you if you tithe. So you have to decide, do I want his gross blessings or his net blessings? I mean, it's up to you, okay? That's how God taught me to tithe. I went to church. The man of God opened the Bible, the Word of God, and taught me about tithing. And I could have walked out that day and said, Brother Jones, that was a good message, and not made a commitment. And it would have amounted to nothing to me. If you're here tonight and you're not a tither, and I remember Brother Jones said, if you don't tithe, you're robbing God. And I thought, I wouldn't want to rob anybody, but I really want to rob God. And he didn't say this, but my dear friend, if you don't tithe, you are robbing yourself. You're robbing yourself of the blessings of God and of the joy of knowing that you're doing what God told you to do. That's how God taught me to tithe. Fast forward to 1968. We were home from furlough. My mother was dying. We came home a little early. And I was preaching in a mission conference at the Marquette Manor Baptist Church in Chicago, Illinois. Dr. Wayne Van Gilderen, Sr., the pastor. So I preached Sunday morning and Sunday night. And then Monday night, Tuesday night, and Wednesday night, Dr. Van Gilderen had Dr. Billy McCarroll, who is pastor of Cicero Bible Church, a great missionary church, to come and teach his church about faith, promise, giving. Now, I'd been a pastor in Kentucky. I'd been the associate pastor in Harvey, Illinois. I'd been a missionary in Japan. I'd never heard the term faith, promise, giving in 1968. And I listened Monday night as Dr. Billy McCarroll expounded 2 Corinthians 8 and 9. And he said three or four things I really like. Number one, he said, faith promise is real simple. You have a mission conference, you have a mission emphasis, and sometimes during that time, you encourage everybody in the congregation to make a commitment to give something every week above the regular tithe and offering. Simple, amen. I like simple things. Abraham Lincoln once said, God must have loved simple people. He made so many of us, amen. I like simple things. I thought, that's good, it's simple. Then he said, it's successful. And he gave illustration after illustration after illustration about churches that were just taking 10% of their budget and giving that to mission. And then they began to give by faith, as is taught in 2 Corinthians 8 and 9. And their mission giving increased exponentially. Now, I could give you literally hundreds and hundreds of churches that I've presented faith promise in that were giving very nominally. For instance, 2 missionaries. But last year, $1.6 million. Pretty good growth, amen? By the way, I don't deserve one bit of the credit for that. That's your pastor. Okay? And that's the word of God. And that's your faithfulness. You listened and you obeyed. So he said, it's successful. And I thought, hey, if you're going to do something, you might as well be successful, amen? So I like that. And then he said, it's scriptural. And by the way, even though it's simple and even though it's successful, if it was not scriptural, then we as Baptists would not be compelled to think much about it. But if it's scriptural, then everybody ought to do it. And by the way, it works everywhere. I never will forget preaching in the Philippines. Conference on World Evangelism. Mindanao Conference on World Evangelization. And there were about 150, 200 senior pastors. A couple of Bible schools was represented. It was a wonderful conference. And a young man from the Philippines that's going to be involved in Asia spiritual taught them about faith promise giving. And it threw him aside. Here are people poor, poor. But every one of those pastors committed himself to go back home and teach their people about faith promise. One of our missionaries said to me one time, he was in an area in the Philippines, and he said, these people are too poor to give. And I said, okay, Mel, that's the best way to keep them poor. Don't teach them how to give. Right. Hey, listen to this verse. Give and it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall men give into your bosom. Does that say, if the economy is good, give and it shall be? No. Just give and it shall be given unto you. So it works everywhere in the world. Let me give you just one verse about faith promise giving. And really, every person here tonight, every man, every woman, every boy, every girl, ought to give something every week to missions above your regular tithe and offering. Hey, by the way, parents, please teach your children to give to missions. Amen. You've heard the story of John D. Rockefeller, the world's first billionaire. Can you imagine being a billionaire? Could you even imagine being a millionaire? For some of us, they have a hard time thinking about being a thousandaire, amen? But you think about it, the world's first billionaire. Here's his testimony. It's on Randy Alcorn's generous giving page. He delivered the grit, made a dollar his first week, 10 dimes. He did different customers. And he got home that day, and his mother set him down at the table, put those 10 dimes in a row, and picked up one of them and said, John, this dime belongs to God. Everything God gives you, you're to give one-tenth of that back to God. Now, here is John D. Rockefeller's testimony. If my mother had not taught me to give the tithe of my first dollar, I would have a hard time tithing my first million. And I guarantee you, there was a Baptist preacher somewhere that was glad his mother taught him how to tithe, amen? Hey, teach your children to give. Amen. You say, maybe a dime a week, doesn't make any difference. Teach them to give. Every man, every woman, every woman. Here's the verse, 2 Corinthians 9:7. Every man, now listen carefully. Every man, according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give. Not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. Now listen to it again. Every man. Now I know when you say that, a lot of the women say, amen, let the men give. But he's not talking about gender. Every mankind, every man, according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give. Not grudgingly or of necessity, God loves a cheerful giver. Everybody ought to give something. Now listen to the verse again. Every man, according as he can figure out from his budget, so let him give. Is that what your Bible says? If it is, you got a real bad translation, amen? Now listen to it. Every man, according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give. Hey, folks, realizing that everything belongs to God and everything we have came from God, and that one day we're going to give an account to God, and hearing the needs of the world that we've heard this week, let God get a hold of your heart. Don't just put down a number. Well, I'll do this. No, no, no. Let God speak to your heart. Every man, according as he purposeth in his heart. What does that mean? That means he thinks about it. Hey, this didn't slip up on you. You've known it was coming. Amen. You've had time to think about it and pray about it. Every man, every woman, every boy, every girl, according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give. And I like the rest of it. Not grudgingly or necessity. No. We don't give because we have to. You don't have to give to faith promise. Paul said very plainly, I speak not by commandment. He's talking about giving to faith promise, giving to mission. I speak not by commandment, but by the occasion and the forwardness of others, and to prove the sincerity of your love. Every once in a while, we make the mistake of saying things like this. Well, it's Sunday, I have to go to church. They're going to take up an offering, I have to put something in. They're going door knocking, I have to go. Hey, let's reprogram our mind tonight. It's Sunday, I get to go to church, amen? By the way, from the time I got saved, I wanted to go to church. I hated when our church had a women's meeting, because I couldn't go. I mean, man, we don't have to go to church. We get to go to church. We don't have to give. We get to give. We don't have to go soul winning. We don't have to be missionaries. We don't have to. No, we get to do that. Think about it. We get to work with the sovereign God of the universe in the greatest task in the world, and that is getting the gospel of Jesus Christ to a lost and dying world. I speak not by commandment, but by the occasion and the forwardness of others. I want you to see what others are doing. And he was talking about those poor churches that back in Macedonia. And then I want you to prove the sincerity of your love. When you fill out that part on missions or fields, and you put that amount in there, you are proving whether you love what God loves, and God loves missions. For God so loved the world. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. You're proving your love or your lack of love for the Lord and what he loved. To prove the sincerity of your love. Faith promise. I learned about faith promise. My first faith promise was a whopping $5 a week. And I know you say, well, you didn't have much faith. I was a missionary in Japan with less than $500 a month support. It took some faith. But for 54 years, now tonight I'm making my 54th commitment.
Amen.
Every year I have increased my giving.
Amen.
Now, if I get much older, I don't know what I'll do, okay? No, I will. As long as God lets me live, I'll give more this coming year than I've ever given before.
Amen.
I couldn't start where I'm at now, okay? But start somewhere. And by the way, don't cheat yourself and don't cheat God. Every man according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give. That's how I learned about faith promise giving. I don't know whether Marquette Manor Baptist Church got it or not, but I got it. And since 1968, I have preached in more than 2,000 mission conferences. And every mission conference I go to, I preach about faith promise. It works. It works. I've had pastors say, well, it wouldn't work here. It won't work if you don't preach it. If you preach it and tell the people what it's all about, it'll work anywhere in the world. Worked in the Philippines. I never will forget in the Philippines, a woman, three children, and her husband was in a mental institution. And I remember that woman at a mission conference there in Brother Bruce Rice's church, bringing me three pineapples and saying, teacher, I don't have any money, but I want to give something to missions. And I said to Brother Bruce, I said, Bruce, have some of your workers take these pineapples and sell them. This might be the biggest mission gift you'll ever get. Everybody can do something. Every man, every woman, every boy, every girl. Now, real quickly, let me tell you two other things. I learned about tithing. I learned about faith promise giving. Same year, 1968, I was preaching in Detroit, Michigan, in a preacher's meeting. And I heard Brother Hafford Ogilvie. And I thought he was an old man. He was about 75 years old. I was 36 years old, so that was old, ancient. And of course, now I know he was just in the prime of life, amen? But I heard him read this verse. Remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how he said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. And he preached about the joy of giving. And hey, I was tithing, I was giving a mission, but sometimes it wasn't so joyful, amen? You've been there, huh? No, you're lying by saying amen, not saying amen, okay? But I heard this dear godly man preach about the joy of giving. And I mean, he brought it in such a way that God dealt with my heart. And by the way, from that time, one of the greatest joys I can possibly have is to be a giver. It is more joyful. Now, Jesus said that. It's more joyful to give than to receive. And by the way, nobody knows more about giving than Jesus. And I learned about the joy of giving. You say, brother, sister, you like to give thanks? Sure, I like to give thanks. But I'll be honest with you. I get a whole lot more joy about giving than I do about receiving. By the way, if you just live to give, you're totally dependent on somebody else giving you something. But if you live to give, you can always find somebody that needs something that you have. 2003, we came to West Coast Baptist College. Every February, we have a big offering. It's run somewhere between, since I've been here at least, $1,500,000 to $2,500,000. And I was preaching out every week. Every week I'd preach somewhere, you know, in the area, representing BIMI, and, you know, representing the school and so forth. And Virginia was here in this, heard that preaching at Dr. Chapel and the testimonies of people giving. It came time for us to make up our mind what we're going to give, okay? So I said, tell you what, Virginia, you put down on a piece of paper what you think we ought to give in the offering. And I put down on a piece of paper what I think we ought to give. And we revealed to each other what we'd put down. And I looked at what she had written down there. And here's what I thought. Dr. Paul Chapel and the people at Lancaster Baptist Church has brainwashed you. If we gave that much money to missions, we'd probably starve next week. Amen. Honestly, I couldn't believe the number she wrote down there. And then God spoke to my heart, well, hey, if your wife has that much faith, you ought to do what she told you to do. And I learned the lesson about extravagant giving. Extravagant giving. Many of you have learned it. Many of you haven't. Extravagant giving. Here's a good example of it. In Bethany, they were having a big banquet for Jesus. Mary, Martha, Lazarus was there. Simon, the leper, was there. The disciples were there. Over in Jerusalem, they were plotting how they're going to kill him. The religious leaders. But here in Bethany, they were honoring Jesus. And imagine, Mary is sitting over there, and she looks at Jesus. And she looks at Simon. And she thinks, I remember when Simon was a leper. Look, he's cleansed. I remember when my brother was dead, entombed. And both Martha and I, when we saw Jesus coming, we ran out there to meet him, and we told him, he's too late. If you'd have been here, my brother wouldn't have died. It's too late. And I remember him saying, well, let's go out to the tomb. We went out to the tomb. And I remember looking, and there were tears in his eyes. By the way, Jesus knew what he was going to do. But when his people were crying, he was crying. And my dear friend, it doesn't matter what you ever go through, Jesus is sympathetic with you. And then Mary thought, and I remember him saying to some men, roll away the stone from that tomb. And, you know, Martha and I said, no, don't do that, Lord. He's been dead 4 days. He's stinking. And by the way, it's all right to stink when you've been dead 4 days, okay? Just don't stink while you're living, okay? And then Mary said, and I remember him crying out, Lazarus, come forth. And my brother got up out of that tomb and came forth. I remember how sinful I was. And I remember how he forgave me of all my sin. And hour after hour, I've had the privilege of sitting at his feet. And she thought, I've got to do something. I've got to do something. She had an alabaster box. Very expensive ointment. In fact, Judas said, it could have been sold for 300 pence and given to the poor. And by the way, he wasn't thinking about the poor. He was thinking about himself. He was a treasure. It could have been, so 300 pence, that's about a year's salary. Think about it. In our term, it'd be $60,000-$70,000. By the way, she didn't buy that ointment at Walmart, amen? That was very expensive. And she thought, I've got to do something. And she broke that alabaster box. And she anointed the Lord. And by the way, she had been sitting at his feet, and she knew he was going to be crucified and die for her sins. And she wiped his feet with the hairs of her head. I've got to do something. I've got to do something for him. He cleansed Simon. He raised my brother from the dead. He forgave me of my sin. I've got to do something. And love does not ask how much, but how. Now, you can give without loving, but you can't love without giving. And God taught me through Dr. Paul Chappell in Lancaster Baptist Church. And by the way, thank you. Thank you for teaching about extravagant giving. And I don't know how many times since that time, Brother Chappell, that God has laid on my heart to do something that I was not capable of doing. But I did it. And guess what? Every time, God supplied. Listen to what he said to the church at Philippi. But my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory. The church at Philippi had given to the ministry of the Apostle Paul in such a way it created a need in their own lives. And Paul said, don't worry about it. God will provide for you. My God shall provide all your need. Tonight, we're going to vote. I don't know what the vote will be as far as the senators and House and so forth. But I know there's something far more important than that. And that's what you're going to vote to do tonight. You're going to vote about the heathen. What you do or don't do will determine whether some people have a chance to hear the gospel and get saved, or whether they live all their life and never one time hear the gospel. Don't rob God and don't rob yourself. Don't fail to give to world evangelization. Hey, and don't do it grouchily. I was with Tim Starr years ago, and He said, now we're going to take an offering, but he said, if you can't give it cheerfully, just keep it. And I thought that might be dangerous in a Baptist church. Amen. I was with Tom Wallace some months after that. He said, now God loves a cheerful giver, but he'll take it from an old grouch, okay? And I thought, well, he might, but the grouch will lose his reward. What we're talking about tonight, not something we have to do. It's something we get to do. We get to invest in eternity. We're laying up treasures in heaven. Pastor.
Let's stand together for a moment with our heads bowed and eyes closed. I want our ushers to come with our commitment cards. No one's moving. Just take a moment to stretch and stand. As the piano plays, I want you to take a moment and pray about what we've heard and about what God would have us to do. In a moment, we'll be on our way, but right now, I want you to pray. What does God want you to do tonight? With our heads bowed and eyes closed, I'll ask our missionaries to come to the platform at this time. Stand behind me, please, all of our missionaries. Father, as we stand before you, we've been instructed by your 89-year-old servant, a man who 55 times in a row has made commitments like we're being asked to make tonight. Thank you for his wonderful counsel to us. Father, we pray tonight that you would help us to have wisdom and faith. Help us to send these new missionaries along their way, that others might hear the gospel and be saved. Bless this time of commitment and faith, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Just remain standing for a moment there. Let's have all our missionaries. Brother Young, you down there with your wife is fine. Some of our missionaries tonight are over in the Spanish department, and they'll have a commitment time there as well. But before we distribute the cards, I want you to meet our missionaries. And come on, Brother Snyder, you and your wife as well. And we want to meet all of them tonight. And Mrs. Young's down here because of her ailment, and so I'm going to walk over here to the Youngs, and I want you to tell us again your name and your field, if you would.
Adam and Angela Young, missionaries to Russia for 20 years.
Amen. Don Sisk, I don't know what I am.
David Snyder and Barb Snyder, BIMI.
Brother Snyder's the director at BIMI, does not take a salary. He's supported as a missionary in that position.
Nathan and Jewel Lear with three of our kids going to Portland, Oregon.
Church planters, that's what we call home missions, okay?
Sam and Juliana Hutchins, Christchurch, New Zealand.
Richard and Michelle Kovan, South Korea.
The LaBelle family going to serving in Sierra Leone, West Africa. Thank you.
Olivia West, missionary to Romania.
Missionaries to the U.S. military worldwide.
And we're grateful to have these missionaries here. And I'm going to ask you if you would just stand here before us as a visual, as our ushers pass out the commitment cards. Ushers, if you'll do that very quickly, just letting you stretch for a moment here. Just pass down one for everyone in the balcony. If you'd grab some of them up there, staff, and pass those around as well. And we want to take a moment to pray. Once you get this into your hand, then we'll be seated, fill them out. And in a moment, we'll be on our way. If you're a new member, this is how we budget for our missions. And if you look at this and fill this out, it'll help us to know how many new missionaries to take on, how we can increase missions. Some of you may want to turn it in on Sunday after you pray a little more, and that's fine too. But many of us have been praying, and we're ready to fill this out in a moment. So right now, let's get them at least into our hands, and then we'll have a word of prayer and ask the Lord to use this time in our lives as a church and as individuals. Anybody not have a card, raise your hand. We want to make sure everybody got one. All right, a couple in the back there. And on my right, Brother Sims, and the very back on the right, a couple on your left, Brother Smithy, right there. And so just keep your hands up if we missed you. We want to get these out. We want to cast a vote tonight for worldwide evangelization. Up in the balcony, do you need cards up there still? All right, there's some coming. Let's pray together. Father, tonight we have been challenged by the testimonies and by the message, and I pray now that what we write on these cards would reflect faith, would reflect biblical conviction, and would be pleasing to you. May we never doubt in the night what you give us in the light, and may we be faithful to follow you and to help in the worldwide cause of evangelization. Bless every member tonight, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. Take a moment there and fill out your card. Ushers, if you'll prepare our offering plates and be on your way up ready to receive these in just a moment. We'll take a moment right now. Teenagers can have a part. Single adults, everyone can have a part. Check your numbers. You'll notice the top portion says, keep this portion. I understand this constitutes a promise between me and God. I further understand I'll not be contacted if for some reason I'm unable to keep this commitment. This is not about the church badgering you. This is about you just thinking about your stewardship. Just like you made a commitment when you buy a house or when you do something of this nature, we're committing to the Lord. And some people say, well, I don't believe in making commitments like this. Well, we make them all the time, and we believe the Lord is worthy, and so we're making that commitment to Him tonight. I want you to take a moment now and detach the card and keep the top portion in your wallet, in your purse, or in your pocket. And ushers, if you'll come, we're going to receive these commitments, and we're going to then tabulate them and tabulate those that come in on Sunday. Some of you that are watching online can get a card on Sunday, fill that in, and call the church office if you're shut in and you want us to mail you one. And we'll be able to combine all of the count and let you know in about 2 weeks how the commitment came together. Let's pray as we receive this tonight. Father, tonight we pray that you would bless these commitments. May our church be a church that never grows weary in well-doing. Bless every commitment tonight, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, ushers, if you'll pass these plates, and you can turn these into the offering plate this time. Thank you.
thank the Lord for every commitment that has been made and for the privilege that is ours to support missionaries. And I want you to look across the platform tonight, and I want you to realize that several of these families are leaving this week to go back to foreign soil to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I want you to take a moment right now and thank them for the privilege they've given us to support them in worldwide missions as our missionaries. A lot of times children grow up and they idolize someone who can slam a leather ball through a basket or hit a ball over a fence, and those are fun things to know about and talk about, but these are the heroes that you should point your children to, people who practice Romans 12 and give themselves to Jesus. These are our heroes tonight, and we love them and we honor them. And I'm going to ask you, if you would, to find your tables in the back one more time, because this is maybe our last chance this side of heaven to meet them, to get their prayer card, and to be able to thank them for being our ambassadors overseas. And would you thank Dr. Sis for that great message tonight? What a blessing. Well, tonight, as we come to the closing moments of this service, I want to say what a joy it is to be your pastor, how I love you and thank God for you. And we've had now 37 missions conferences, and God's allowed us to see many great things. But here tonight, on a rainy Southern California night, election night, we were able as a church to do something great for God. And I'm so grateful for His grace upon our church and upon our lives. And I believe what Brother Sis said, the best is yet to come. And I'm not discouraged about California or how the election goes or doesn't go tonight, because I know who's on the throne tonight. And I'm the servant of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And I live on the winning side in Christ Jesus. And we were able to see something. And folks, it's amazing to me, and I say this to the glory of God, but even here in California, we have just participated in one of the greatest missions conferences that will take place in this entire nation this year. And I would rather be in the center of the will of God, seeing Him do things like this, than finding my own personal comfort zone. I'm so glad that we can be a part of the great work that God is doing right here in California, because the darker the night, the brighter the light. And so let's remember to give God thanks. Brother Sisk, I'm going to let you stay right up here tonight. Folks, come up and say hi to Brother Sisk and thank him for that message. I'll be out in the West Wing lobby. Missionaries are all around you, and I hope you'll take some time. I don't know what the weather is outside, but be careful, and we'll look forward to seeing you in just a few days. I'll be preaching Sunday morning from the book of Esther on God's deliverance of His people, and Sunday night from the book of 2 John, and I'm excited about these messages. God bless you. Have a wonderful evening. Mm-hmm.